Hey guys, this is Vaish from Vaish IAS. So we are going to continue the Satish Chandra series, which we had restarted last week, which actually it was going on 1 month back, and then we had to stop it because of other reasons, and then now we are restarting it. Okay, so chapter 1 was done, which was India and the world, and now we'll do chapter 2, which is North India. Okay, 8th to 10th AD. Okay, like in last chapter I told you, like the beginning of 8th century is what we consider the starting of medieval history. Okay, ancient history till that age I have already covered. R. S. Sharma entire textbook, 27 chapters is done. So watch that. Okay, it's always good to see ancient first and then medieval, then modern. Okay, modern anyway can be done separately also, because the things totally change. Okay, so modern was done long back, spectrum, so that also you can watch. So this one, this chapter is about three empires. Okay, the Palas, Pratiharas and Rashtrakutas. So three empires in different locations and their struggles and all during this timeline. So it will be more of political history. A lot of ruler names will be there, and their administration, the different ministers, what it is called. So lot of terminologies are there. So what you should do is you should make notes of it. Okay, else it's very difficult to recollect. It's always good to do a comparative study of three empires. So make an Excel sheet where you have three columns, like Pratiharas, Palas and Rashtrakutas. So as and when common things are there, put it under the rows. Okay, like ruler names, put it in one box under every three columns. Same way, there'll be like some traveler who came during the time of Pratiharas or who came to the Pala. So put a subheading like a traveler, and then against traveler, write the three traveler names against each one of them. Okay, that is how we make our revision charts also. So it's not a very big thing to create it by yourself. So as and when you learn something, when there is comparative things, put it under one sheet so that you can, in one glance, you can revise everything together. Okay. So before that, test series, again many queries have been coming every day. This mains test series, as I told, it's closed already because of the timings. I have explained it in at least three videos, like why we are stopping it. The current batches are going on, which will end in February 17th. Okay, and by February 19th the notification of UPSC will come, and so our students would be already completed the entire syllabus for mains. Okay, then next important thing is the prelims practice, which already June month onwards we have been monthly delivering PDFs of both current affairs and static subjects. So totally we'll have 65 tests. Okay, 65 test papers are there with the detailed solution. Okay, it's like more than a magazine, you can call. That much explanation is there for each and every question. Okay, every option and whatever needed. So that is open, so students can buy it. So this ad we have been putting out in Facebook and YouTube, and so we have been getting a lot of queries every day. Okay, so most students who are new to our channel don't know the delivery scheme, like how it is delivered monthly wise. So this two Excel sheet, this two images, just pause and see. Okay, this is the dynamic part which is getting delivered every month. Okay, 20 tests, which is like 12 current affairs of the upcoming months, that is June 2018, that is after the prelims was over, from that time till the next prelims. Okay, the one full 12 months cycle, 12 month this current affair will be there, and then 6 full tests, and then the upcoming economic survey and India yearbook. So 12 plus 6 plus 2, 20 tests is the dynamic thing, and these are the delivery dates. Just pause and see. Okay, till May 15th you will have the delivery. Okay, and June 2nd is your prelims. Same way, on the same dates, 4th of every month, 4th July, August, September, like this, by December or January, you will be getting entire static subjects. Okay, 45 tests are there with 150 revision charts, and the new addition is the snippet cards. If you don't know what it is, you watch the recent video. Okay, it is there. Last 2-3 videos, anything you watch, you will understand what is the snippet cards. So all this is a whole package. Okay, whatever is needed for prelims, 100% syllabus coverage is done. So this is the delivery timeline. So those who are new, maybe this will help. Okay, so please pause it and read, because I don't want to waste more time on this thing now. So we'll go on to the chapter. Okay, so North India, the age of three empires, and the timeline is 8th to 10th century. Okay, this whole textbook will go in a timeline. Okay, so like next chapter will be, I think, 10th to 12th century. Okay, so that time it will be, I think, Chola Empire and the South Indian Kingdoms. So first we'll see the North Indian Kingdoms, what was happening during this time. Okay, so I'll read through, and if it's very much political, I'll be reading it very fast, but if it is like factual, which is needed for prelims, then I'll repeat it one more time. So make notes immediately. Okay, pause wherever needed and then make notes, because else it will video will take like more time to complete. Now, number of powerful empires arose in northern India and the Deccan between 750 AD and 1000 AD. So these were the Pala Empire, which dominated eastern India till the middle of the 9th century, the Pratihara Empire, which dominated western India and the upper Gangetic Valley till the middle of the 10th century, and the Rashtrakuta Empire, which dominated the Deccan and also controlled territories in north and south at various times. Okay, so three kingdoms, okay, Pala in the east, Pratihara in the west, and Rashtrakuta is kind of Deccan area, but they had control over the north also. Okay, so there will be a tri-juncture kind of point, okay, and that point will be Kannauj, okay, that we'll see in the next paragraph. So each of these empires, although they fought among themselves, provided stable conditions of life over large areas and gave patronage to arts and letters of the three. Arts and letters. Okay, so culture wise also it is there. So now, of the three, the Rashtrakuta Empire lasted the longest. Okay, so that's also one not very difficult to remember, but you can try to recollect. Okay, like this is the longest one. So it was not only the most powerful empire of the time, but also act as a bridge between North and South India. Okay, because the location is like that. Okay, Deccan. Now, in economic as well as cultural matters. So this is just a whole idea of the locations of the three. Now we'll go into details. Okay, so the struggle for domination, so one by one we'll see. First will be like, I think half a page or one page is full of Palas. Okay, so following the reign of Harsha, Kannauj was considered the symbol of sovereignty of North India, a position which Delhi was to acquire later. Okay, so now laterly, you know, like medieval, when Mughal Empire and all those things are there, it is the Delhi which is important. So before that it was Kannauj. Okay, and before that it was Harsha's reign. So Harsha's reign and all we have done in ancient history already. So Kannauj is the symbol of sovereignty of the North India. Okay, that time. So controlling Kannauj means it's like a very big thing at that time. Okay, so that's what we are going to discuss. Control of Kannauj also implied control of the upper Gangatic Valley and its rich resources. Okay, you know the Ganga basin, it's like full of the fertile soil is also there, and also mineral resources, everything is there. So it's very much important for anyone, for any dynasty to flourish. Okay, so that is why this Kannauj is important, both trade and agriculture. Okay, in addition, the Palas and Pratiharas clashed with each other for the control of the area extending from Banaras to South Bihar. Okay, that is UP Bihar area. Okay, which again had rich resources and well-developed traditions. The Pratihara clashed with the Rashtrakutas also. So it's just telling these three people were clashing with each other for this control of this area. The Pala Empire was founded by Gopala. Okay, so this is one term which, or one name which everybody don't know. Okay, because when Pala is there, most people confuse it with Dharmapala, who is one of the most popular ruler, okay, of Pala Empire. But the founder is not Dharmapala. Okay, it is Gopala. So probably in 750 AD, when he was elected king by the notable men of the area to end the anarchy prevailing there. So he was like by notable men and all, selected this person, and that is how it became. The Pala Empire was founded in around 750 AD. Okay. Now, he was succeeded in 770 by his son Dharmapala, who ruled till 810. Okay. So see, this is like only 20 years. Okay. This is Gopala. But after that, around how much? 40 years or something, it is Dharmapala. Then Dharmapala was defeated by the Rashtrakuta ruler Dhruva. Okay, so this is what I told, a lot of names will come. So if you have an Excel sheet open and under each of the headings, you can start putting the people name. Okay, because a lot of names will come. The political names were, it's not you asked in recent UPSC exams, but at least 5 years back and all, UPSC used to ask. Okay, they'll ask like, he is the founder of this thing, or he defeated him. They used to do comparative statements, or at least match the following will come. So you should know the names, so put it in Excel. Okay, so Gopala and Dharmapala is Pala rulers, Dhruva is a Rashtrakuta ruler. Okay, now he is like, he defeated this person Dharmapala also, and he also defeated the Pratihara ruler. Okay, but after these signal victories, Dhruva returned to the Deccan, leaving the field free to Dharmapala, who occupied Kannauj. So this person is like, he went and defeated these people, but he did not stay there, he went back to the Deccan region. Okay, Rashtrakuta. So what happened is, again Dharmapala will take over the Kannauj area. Held a grand darbar there, which was extended by vassal rulers. Vassal means like subordinate rulers from Punjab, Eastern Rajasthan, etc. But Dharmapala could not consolidate his control over Kannauj. The Pratihara power revived under Nagabatta II. So now this is a Pratihara ruler. Okay, this is Nagabatta II. Dharmapala fell back, but was defeated near Mongir, Bihar. Okay, a place near Bihar. It's not very important. Maybe history optional students should know where it is in map. And modern East UP remained a bone of contention between the Palas and the Pratiharas, though Bihar, in addition to Bengal, remained under the control of Palas for most of the time. So whatever conflicts were happening, the eastern side, okay, the Bihar UP area, Bengal area, it was mostly under Palas only. Okay, even though a lot of conflicts happened. Now, failure in the north compelled the Pala rulers to turn their energies to other directions. Okay, so people were looking for other resources, other directions also. It's not like they'll keep fighting in the same place. Now, Devpala, the son of Dharmapala. Okay, so now the order is Gopala, Dharmapala, and Devpala. Okay, who succeeded to the throne in 810 and ruled for 40 years. So again, 40 years. Okay, his son also extended his control over Pragjyotishpur, Assam. Okay, this also, again, as I told, 5 to 10 years back and all, UPSC used to ask. Okay, like which place is like the which is relating to the modern day, which city or modern day which place. So this but Pragjyotishpur is like in Assam or referring to Assam, okay, and the parts of Orissa. Probably a part of modern Nepal was also brought under Pala suzerainty. So again, see, it's all eastern side, okay, Assam, Orissa, Nepal, everything is like coming under this Pala. Now, thus for about 100 years, from the middle of the 8th to the middle of the 9th century, the Pala rulers dominated East India. For some time, their control extended up to Varanasi. Their power is attested to by an Arab merchant, Sulaiman. So, okay, this is what I told. Like this, some traveler or merchant, someone will be there who is associated with one kingdom. Okay, so Pala, it is Sulaiman, okay, who is an Arab merchant, who visited India in the middle of the 9th century and wrote an account of it. He calls the Pala kingdom Rahma or Dharma, okay, short for Dharmapala. Okay, so this also, like, whom did he refer to, or like that kind of one statement, if it comes, it will become very difficult for you to recollect, okay, because that many names we learn, and in the exam hall, recollecting these names will be very difficult. So make note of it, okay. Pala kingdom is referred to like this by Sulaiman, okay, Arab merchant. And and he's telling the same thing. Pala ruler was at war with his neighbors, the Pratiharas and the Rashtraputas, but his troops were more numerous than his adversaries. So according to him, okay, it can be like overstated also, but he's telling like he Palas had the most number of army men or their cavalry, everything. Okay, here they are again telling the numbers, 50,000 elephants, 10 to 50,000 men. It's all not important. The fact is that they had more compared to the neighbors. So information about the Palas is also provided to us by the Tibetan chronicles, although these were written down in the 17th century. Okay, so later written Tibetan chronicles also tells about the Pala kingdom. According to these, the Pala rulers were great patrons of Buddhist learning and religion. The Nalanda University, which had been famous all over the Eastern world, was revived by Dharmapala. Okay, it's like revived. Okay, it's not like set up. It was set up long back before that. Okay, in the ancient times itself. Now it's a medieval time, so Dharmapala revived it. And 200 villages were set apart for meeting its expenses. He also founded the Vikramshila University. Okay, so now Vikramshila University is founded by Dharmapala. Nalanda University is revived by Dharmapala. Okay, so these are factual things we should know, which became second only to Nalanda in fame. It was located at the top of a hill on banks of the Ganga in Magadha amidst pleasant surroundings. The Palas built many viharas in which a large number of Buddhist monks lived. So it's like religion wise they are telling. Tibetan Chronicles is mentioning that they were like great Buddhists, great learners. Dharmapala revived these things, founded this thing. So these are factual things about Buddhism. The Pala rulers also had close cultural relation with Tibet. The noted Buddhist scholar Santarakshita and Dibankara, called Atisa, were invited to Tibet, and they introduced a new form of Buddhism there. As a result, many Tibetan Buddhists flocked to the universities of Nalanda and Vikramshila for study. Okay, so we obviously know like they all came these places to study, but here two names are mentioned. Okay, this Santarakshita and Dibankara. Okay, so these are noted Buddhist scholars contemporary to Pala ruling. Okay, so this contemporary thing is also very important. UPSC will ask as the following. Okay, so make a note. Now, the Palas had close trade contacts and culture link with Southeast Asia. The trade with Southeast Asia was very profitable and added greatly to the prosperity of Pala Empire. The powerful Sailendra dynasty, which was Buddhist in faith and which ruled over Malaya, Java, Sumatra and the neighboring islands, sent many embassies to the Pala court and sought permission to build a monastery at Nalanda, and also requested the Pala ruler Dev Pala to endow five villages for its upkeep. The request was granted and bears testimony to the close relation between the two. So again telling this relation between Palas and the Southeast Asia. Okay, this Java, Sumatra, that is Indonesia, Malaysia region. They had ties, and the dynasty there was this Sailendra dynasty. And so they are asking like permission to set up a monastery and how it will be funded and all. So some five villages were set up. So this is the overall Pala political history. Okay, so 3-4 names you learnt, some Buddhist scholars, one trader name, the location, the universities and Buddhism. Okay, it's very simple. It's like when you read it like this word by word, it's very simple to understand. You will never forget it. Only maybe names you'll get confused in this thing, but that with practice it will come. Okay, so Palas we have done. Now we'll see Pratiharas. Pratiharas are also called Gujjar Pratiharas. Okay, why? Because it's in the Gujarat region. Okay, now and southwestern Rajasthan. Now they were at first probably local officials, but were able to carve out a series of principalities in central and eastern Rajasthan. They gained prominence on account of their resistance to Arab incursions from Sindh into Rajasthan. However, the Arabs were decisively defeated by Chalukya rulers of Gujarat. Okay, so in 738 AD, this Arabs were defeated, and that is how these people made sure that now that danger is not there. Arabs' danger is not there, and so like that they become rulers here. Okay, the efforts of the early Pratihara rulers to extend their control over the upper Ganga Valley and the Malwa were defeated by the Rashtrakuta rulers Dhruva. Okay, again this Dhruva which we saw, and Gopal III. Okay, so again one more name. So this is under Rashtrakuta. Okay. In 790 and again 806, the Rashtrakutas defeated the Pratiharas and then withdrew to the Deccan, leaving the field free for the Palas. So same story which we saw in Palas also. Okay. Perhaps the real interest of the Rashtrakutas was the domination of Malwa and Gujarat. Okay. So this is how they come, they defeat, but they go back. Okay, Rashtrakutas. Now the real founder of Pratihara Empire and the greatest ruler of the dynasty was Bhoja. Okay, so this is the most important name. Like we saw Dharmapala in the Pala dynasty. Here the name is Bhoja. Okay. We do not know much about his early life or when he ascended the throne. He rebuilt the empire, and by about 836, he had recovered Kannauj, which remained the capital of the Pratihara Empire for almost a century. Okay, so the 730, 830 AD and all, this is overruled by these people. Okay, Pratihara under Bhoja. Bhoja tried to extend his sway in the east, but he was defeated and checkmated by the Pala ruler Devpala. Okay, so like this, he's not able to reach east. Okay, but western side he ruled. He then turned towards central India and Deccan and Gujarat. This led to the revival of the struggle with the Rashtrakutas. Okay, so again, three people are fighting with each other. Now a battle happened, okay, on the bank of river Narmada. And Bhoja was able to retain his control over considerable parts of Malwa and some parts of Gujarat. Again, same thing, okay, western side he has control. But he could progress no further in this direction. Hence, he turned his attention to north again. According to an inscription, his territories extended to eastern side of the river Satluj. Okay, Satluj and all, you should know where it is, okay, in this tributary. Now, Arab travelers tells us that the Pratihara rulers had the best cavalry in India. Okay, so it's like Arab travelers again. There when Sulaiman or someone told like Palas had the biggest army and all. Here again some Arab travelers are telling like they had the best cavalry. Okay, import of horses from Central Asia and Arabia was an important item of India's trade at that time. Okay, so these are like very understood, like easily rememberable fact. Okay, but still UPSC can ask like whether these people used to import horses or export horses. This kind of thing they will ask, so you should know. Following the death of Devpala and the weakening of the Pala Empire, Bhoja also extended his empire in the east. So after Devpala, Bhoja could get some success in the eastern side also. Okay, so because more important rulers are gone now. Now the name of the Bhoja is famous in legends. Perhaps the adventures of Bhoja in the early part of his life, his gradual conquest of his lost empire and his final recovery of Kannauj struck the imagination of his contemporaries. Okay, so again, telling too much good things about this Bhoja, but we don't need such philosophy here. Bhoja was a devotee of Vishnu and adopted the title Adivaraha. Okay, this is important. Okay, because many rulers are there who have different names. In ancient history also, Samudragupta and all those things, when I was teaching, I told you lot of names. Everyone will take up lot of names. Okay, even in south kingdoms like Pandya and all, they had rulers, Pallavas, they had rulers who had different names. Okay, so that and all, when you read ancient history again, you will know. But this one, make a note, Adivaraha, because Vishnu devotee. Okay, Bhoja, which has been found inscribed in some of his coins. Okay, so coin inscriptions is also there. Like Samudragupta had a coin inscription like of a ship symbol was there, or he himself playing the veena was there. Like that, many things are there which is unique to certain rulers. Such things you should know. Now he is sometimes called Mihir Bhoja. Okay, why it is called? Because to distinguish him from Bhoja Parmara of Ujjain, who ruled a little later. Okay, so after this Bhoja of Pratiharas, later there will be another Bhoja. Okay, so differentiate. So historians or someone whoever have written it, they have called him as Mihir Bhoja also. Okay, so Adivaraha Mihir Bhoja is same person who is the Pratihara king, and later in Ujjain there is another Bhoja. Okay, so that much is clear. Now Bhoja probably died in about 885. He was succeeded by his son Mahendrapala. Okay, so this is one confusing thing which you will have. Okay, this is the Pratihara kingdom, but the name is like, if you see, it's like Pala. You saw Gopala, Dharmapala, Devpala, everyone was in the eastern side, Pala dynasty. But here in Pratihara Empire also, there is a person called Mahendrapala. Okay, Mahendrapala 1, so maybe again more other. So this is like after Bhoja, so this will be very confusing, okay, if you did not read this. So Mahendrapala, who ruled till 908, maintained the empire of Bhoja and extended it over Magadha and North Bengal. His inscriptions have also been found in Kathiawar, East Punjab and Awadh. Mahendrapala fought a battle with the king of Kashmir but had to yield to him. Okay, so Kashmir he tried, but there he lost. Okay. Again, the Pratiharas thus dominated North India for over 100 years, from the first quarter of the 9th to the middle of the 10th. Al Masudi, okay, a native of Baghdad. Okay, Baghdad is Iraq, who visited Gujarat. So there we saw Arab traveler Sulaiman, and here it is Al Masudi. That is why I told you to make an Excel. Now if you had that Excel and you had two columns, you would have filled Sulaiman there and Al Masudi here. Okay, it's very important. Okay, you might be thinking it's very silly fact or something, but UPSC used to ask. So out of 100 prelims question, only maybe 2 questions will come for medieval India. And unfortunately, if UPSC decide to pick this statement and put it, it will be like only people who read this will know. Okay, because these are not very famous people, or it's not too much repeated in other lectures or anywhere. Okay, so make notes. There's no harm in making learning these facts or just glancing it before prelims. So testifies the great power and just prestige of the Pratihara. So he is like same like how Sulaiman did. Now this person is telling all good things about this Pratihara dynasty. Okay, he calls it like something here, Al Juzr or something. Okay, a corrupt form of Gujra. Okay, this Gujarat only in his Arabic kind of version, he's telling this Al Juzr. Okay, same way we saw something for the other one also. Try to recollect what Sulaiman told for this thing, Pala. Okay, now again telling about this Boja, these many villages, these many length and width, it's all statistics, so it's not required. Now with the army of the north, he fights against the ruler of Multan and other Muslims who align themselves with him. Okay, the army of the south fought against the Rashtrakutas and the east. Again telling about their fighting style. Okay, north they are fighting, south they are fighting these many elephants, cavalry and all that. Now the Pratiharas were patrons of learning and literature. The great Sanskrit poet and dramatist Rajashekhar lived at the court of Mahipala, okay, grandson of Boja. Okay, so like Boja we saw, after him it was Mahendrapala or something, now then it is Mahipala. Okay, and under him court poet is Rajashekhar. Okay, this court poet, we have a revision chart itself. Okay, there are like at least 12 to 13 court poet names which you have to learn. Okay, for your overall history, I am telling at least 8 to 10 or 10 to 12 maybe. Overall, medieval, ancient, everything together, and everything is important. So they can ask a match the following easily, like who is the court poet of who. Okay, so this one, Mahipala, Rajashekhar, and the Pratihara Empire. Okay, the Pratihara also embellished Kannauj with many fine buildings and temples. During the 8th and 9th century, many Indian scholars went with embassies to the court of the Caliph at Baghdad. These scholars introduced Indian sciences, especially mathematics, algebra and medicine, to the Arab world. We do not know names of the Indian kings who sent these embassies. The Pratiharas were well known for the hostility to the Arab rulers of Sindh. Despite this, it seems that the movement of scholars and goods between India and West Asia continued during the period. Again, this relation between India and this Western side and Arab, it's like obviously understood. Okay, like Gujarat in the west side of India, so their ties is more with the Arabs. Okay, Palas was there on the east side of India, so their tie was there with the Sailendra dynasty in the Southeast Asia. So it's like geography. Okay, if you know the geography, you will know with whom they had the tie-up. Okay, between 915 and 918, the Rashtrakuta king Indra III. So again, okay, now this is the Rashtrakuta king. Like we saw many names now, Indra III, then what was there? Dhruv was there, and one more was there. Like 2-3 names I showed you, which is Rashtrakuta, which we are yet to read. Okay, now this weekend, the Pratihara Empire and Gujarat probably passed into the hands of Rashtrakutas. For Al Masudi tells us that the Pratihara Empire had no access to the sea. The loss of Gujarat, which was the hub of the overseas trade and the main outlet of North Indian goods, went to goods to Western Asian countries, was another blow to the Pratihara. So overall, it is telling about the defeat. Okay, Rashtrakutas came, this person Indra III came, defeated. They did not have access to sea also. So overall, they lost. Okay, another Rashtrakuta ruler, Krishna III, invaded North India in about 963 and defeated the Pratihara ruler. This was followed by rapid dissolution of the Pratihara Empire. So overall, if you see, like Palas is getting defeated, Pratihara is getting defeated, and finally Rashtrakutas is emerging. Okay, and they will be the longest surviving dynasty. So these people are ruling North India, Palas, Pratiharas. The Deccan was being ruled by the Rashtrakutas, a remarkable dynasty which produced a long line of warriors and able administrators. The kingdom was founded by Danti Durga. Okay, so like this, you should know the name. Okay, like Gopala was for Pala, and Boja Empire, it was someone else. Okay, so you should like this, if that Excel sheet you are filling, it will be very easy. Okay, so Danti Durga, who fixed his capital at Manyakhet or Malkhed near modern Solapur. The Rashtrakutas soon dominated the entire area of northern Maharashtra. Okay, they also engaged with the Pratiharas for the overlordship of Gujarat and Malwa, as we have seen above. Although their raids did not result in the extension of the Rashtrakuta Empire to the Ganga Valley, they brought rich plunder and added to the fame of the Rashtrakutas. Again, same thing, they go fight, get the rich wealth and then come back. The Rashtrakutas also fought constantly against the eastern Chalukyas of Vengi. Okay, so this is in modern Andhra Pradesh. Okay, like for Assam, I showed you something like Jyotishpur or something. So the same way, this thing, Vengi is in modern Andhra Pradesh. And in south, against the Pallavas of Kanchi and the Pandyas of Madurai. Probably the greatest Rashtrakuta king were Govinda III, Amoghavarsha. Okay, so two people are very important. Like many we saw, Dhruv, Indra III, then which was that some other person was there, I forgot the name, Krishna III, I think. So like that, many names we saw, but Govinda and this Amoghavarsha are important. If you see the timeline itself, like this is around 60 to 70 years this person is ruling. Okay, so I don't know like what is his age anyway, because this many years if he is ruling, so we should, it's like maybe debatable. So after a successful expedition against Nagabata of Kannauj and the annexation of Malwa, Govind III turned to the south. We are told in an inscription that Govinda terrified in Kerala, sorry, the Kerala, Pandya and Chola. So again, like overall South Indian victory, okay. It's not very important, like again about war and these things and all. Two statues of the Lord of Lanka were carried to Manyakhet and installed like pillars of victory in front of the Shiva temple. So who installed this statue, that you should know, like it is this Govinda III, okay. Amoghavarsha ruled for 68 years, okay, like you see, 68 years, but by temperament, he preferred the pursuit of religion and literature to war, okay, so he preferred religion and literature more compared to war. He was himself an author and is credited with writing the first Kannada book on poetics, okay, like many years ago, UPSC used to even play with these kind of fact, okay, like he was a Telugu poet, he was a Tamil poet, something that they will change even such very minute factual things. So you should know, like he is in the South India, western side, that is Karnataka region, so it is Kannada, okay. He was a great builder and is said to have built the capital city, okay, that Manyakhet, near that Sholapur or whatever. So there were many rebellions in the far-flung Rashtrakuta Empire under Amoghavarsha. These could be barely contained and began afresh after his death. His grandson Indra III re-established the empire. After the defeat of Mahipala and the sack of Kannauj in 915, Indra III was the most powerful of the times. Again, it's like political history, okay, who came after whom and all. It's not very important. Rashtrakuta King Balara or Vallabh Raja, again one name, okay. Here also this Al Masudi, he's telling about these people, okay. So Suleiman told about Palas and about Pratiharas and Rashtrakutas, this person is telling, Al Masudi, okay, Baghdad person, Iraq. Now Krishna III was the last in line of brilliant rulers, okay. So I don't think they will ask the chronology of all these people, but still if you have that Excel sheet, make a note. He was engaged in a struggle against the Paramaras of Malwa and the eastern Chalukyas of Vengi, okay. This already we saw, another Bhoja is there in this particular dynasty and this Vengi is in Andhra Pradesh. Like that's small facts you will recollect, okay, when you keep on reading. He also launched a campaign against the Chola ruler of Tanjore who had supplanted the Pallavas of Kanchi. Now Krishna III defeated the Chola king Parantaka, these are all we'll see, okay, next chapter we'll see Chola Empire, and annexed the northern part of the Chola Empire. He then pressed down to Rameshwaram and set up a pillar of victory there and built a temple. So here a victory pillar is set up, okay. Same way here we saw some statue, okay. So that was by Govinda III and here it is like Krishna III, okay. If you want to remember, you can remember these kind of things. So some victory pillar and temple was there, and after his death, all his opponents united against his successor. Rashtrakuta capital Malkhed was sacked and burnt in 972. This marked the end of the Rashtrakuta Empire. Okay, so again, further, this Cholas, when they are coming to power, Rashtrakuta is getting over. Okay, that is how each dynasty will come and the other one will go away. So that is how we proceed this textbook also, timeline wise. Now Rashtrakuta ruled in the Deccan, lasted for almost 200 years till the end of the 10th century. Rashtrakuta rulers were tolerant in their religious views and patronized not only Shaivism and Vaishnavism but Jainism as well, okay. So that is also one thing, like all these religions were there. The famous rock cut temple of Shiva at Ellora was built by end of the Rashtrakuta king Krishna I in the 9th century, okay. So this is very important thing, this Ellora temple, okay. YouTube, you will get a video of this, because it is like even now historians are debating like how such a huge structure was built at that time, okay, because it is very like that much unique it is. You watch the video, you will understand, okay. So his successor Amoghavarsha is said to have been a Jain, but he also patronized other faiths. Rashtrakuta allowed allowed Muslim traders to settle and permitted Islam to be preached in their dominion. So again, all religions, okay, everything is there. Hinduism, Muslim, Shaivism, Jainism, Buddhism, everything is there. Now, this tolerant policy helped to promote foreign trade, which enriched the Rashtrakutas. The Rashtrakuta king were great patrons of art and letters. In their court, we find not only Sanskrit scholars, but also poets and others who wrote the Prakrit and in the Apabhramsa, okay, the so-called corrupt languages, which were the forerunners of the various modern Indian languages, okay. So these are like languages which are like leading to the other modern languages, okay, Apabhramsa. So we saw Amoghavarsha was like Kannada, then Sanskrit is there, Prakrit is there. So it's like they are supporting all religions, all languages, okay. That is why their culture is too rich. The great Apabhramsa poet Swayambhu and his son probably lived at the Rashtrakuta court. So again, one more contemporary person, okay. We saw one Rajshekhar was there in Pratihara Empire, okay. Same way here one Swayambhu or something is there in Rashtrakuta, okay. So these kind of things, just make a note. Now, political ideas and organizations. Okay, here a lot of terminologies will be there. So, mostly will be common, but if it's unique, try to recollect. The system of administration in these empires was based on the ideas and practices of the Gupta Empire, Harsha's kingdom in the north, and the Chalukyas in the Deccan. Okay, so a mix of all these things. Now, as before, the monarch was the center of all affairs. He was the head of the administration as well as the commander-in-chief of the armed forces. Okay, so king is the main person, central person, and is in charge of the army and all. He sat in the sat in a magnificent darbar. The infantry and cavalry were stationed at the courtyard. Captured war elephants and horses would be paraded before him. He was attended by royal chamberlains. Everything is like very common. Okay, there is, I don't think it's vassal chiefs against subordinate chiefs, feudatory ambassador. King dispensed justice. The court was not only a center of political affairs and of justice. There is dance and music in his court. These are like any empire that you can imagine. Like, these things will be obviously there. There is nothing unique here. Okay. According to Arab writers, ladies did not veil their faces. Okay. I mean, they did not cover their face or something. So these are like a general, like you can pictureize how Rashtrakuta kingdom looked like, or any, not only Rashtrakuta. They are telling about all the three kingdoms. Okay. The king's position was generally hereditary. Thinkers of the time emphasized absolute loyalty and obedience to the king because of the insecurity at the time. Wars were frequent between kings and between kings and their vassals. While kings strove to maintain law and order within their kingdoms, their arms rarely extended far enough. Vassal rulers and autonomous chiefs often limited the area under district administration. A contemporary writer, okay, Medhaditi, okay, again, this person is around 8th to 10th century. That is only a fact you need to remember, okay. Thinks that it was the right of an individual to bear arms in order to defend himself. Okay, so more kind of liberal view. Okay, this Medhaditi, okay, in 8th to 10th century. He also thinks it was right to oppose an unjust king. Thus, the extreme view of royal rights and privileges put forward mainly in the Puranas was not accepted by all the thinkers. Okay, so even though king's position is high, central, and all those things, there were these kind of liberal thinkers also who used to tell you can go against anything if you feel it is unjust. The rules about succession were not rigidly fixed. The eldest son often succeeded, but there are many instances when the eldest son had to fight his younger brothers and sometimes lost to them. Okay, so there is no specific rule. Okay, generally it is elder son, but fights also happen. Thus, the Rashtrakuta rulers Dhruva and Govind IV deposed their elder brothers. Sometimes rulers designated the eldest son or another favorite son as their Yuvraj or successor. In that case, the Yuvraj stayed at the capital and helped in the task of administration. Young sons were sometimes appointed provincial governors. Princesses were rarely appointed to government post, but we do have an instance when the Rashtrakuta princess, Chandrabolabe, daughter of Amoghavarsha I, administrated the Raichur Dob for some time. Okay. So these are something which is unique. Okay, like remaining everything what we read. Okay, last one half page, I don't think any knowledge you would have got extra. It's like how a kingdom looks like and what is their succession rules and all. But this one person's name, this woman thing, is like unique. It's a Rashtrakuta princess, and she was in charge of Raichur Dob for some time. Okay, so that you can note that name. At least you should know it's from this kingdom. Okay, Rashtrakuta Empire. Now, kings were generally advised by a number of ministers. The ministers were chosen by the king generally from leading families. Their position was often hereditary. Thus, in the case of the Pala kings, we hear that a Brahmana family supplied 4 successive chief ministers to Dharmapala and his successors. In such cases, the minister could become very powerful. Although we hear of a number of departments of the central government, we do not know how many of them were there and how they worked. From epigraphic and literary records, it appears that in almost every kingdom, there was a minister of foreign affairs, revenue minister. See, this is what I'm telling. There is nothing new which you are learning. Okay, these are things which is understood. Like Purohita will be there, Senapati will be there, everything which is there in a kingdom. Okay, more than one post could be combined in one person, and perhaps one of the ministers were considered the chief or the prime minister, on whom the king leaned more than the others. All the ministers except the Purohita were expected to lead military campaigns as well when called upon to do so. So everyone will be called upon for war except for this Purohita. We also hear of officials of the royal household. Okay, Antapur, that is a royal household. Since the king was the fountainhead of all power, some of the officers of household became very important. Okay, the armed forces were very important in the maintenance and expansion of the empire. We have already cited evidence from Arab travelers that the Pala, Pratihara and Rashtrakuta kings had large and well-organized infantry and cavalry. Okay, we already saw that Sulaiman and the Al-Masid or something. They told like they have like huge cavalry, elephants, army, all the things. The largest number of elephants were maintained by the Pala. Okay, like we saw that Sulaiman Silver Still. Now, large number of horses were imported both by Rashtrakuta and Pratihara by sea from Arabia and West Asia and by land from Central Asia. The Pratihara kings are believed to have the finest cavalry in the country. There is no reference to war chariots which had fallen out of use. Some of the kings, especially the Rashtrakutas, had a large number of forts. These were garrisoned by special troops and also had their independent commanders. The infantry consisted of regular and irregular troops and of levies produced by the vassal chiefs. The regular troops were often hereditary. Okay, I think this is the last piece. So sometimes not from different regions all over the India. Okay, thus the Pala infantry consisted of soldiers from Malwa, Khasa, Assam, Lata, South, again some place names. Okay, like soldiers were taken from every place. Now the Pala kings and perhaps the Rashtrakutas had their own navies, but we do not know much about their strength and organizations. Okay, so it's like historians are not sure. Okay, about this thing, Palas and Rashtrakutas, because Pratiharas we already saw, they did not have access to sea and all those things we saw in last page. The empires consisted of areas administered directly and areas ruled over by vassal chiefs. The latter were autonomous as far as their internal affairs were concerned, and had a general obligation of loyalty, paying a fixed tribute and supplying a quota of troops to the overlord. Again, same thing. Okay, the system is there in everywhere. Okay, paying tribute and all those things. When called upon, sometimes the son of vassal chiefs were required to stay in attendance of the overlord to guard against rebellion. The vassal chiefs were required to attend the darbar of their overlord or special occasions. Not at all important. I am skipping these paras. Okay, it's again telling how their court looks like and all these things. Here some terms are there. The directly administered territories in the Pala and Pratihara empires were divided into Bukti. Okay, this Bukti is province. In ancient history, I have already taught you this. Okay, Bukti is provinces, and then Mandala or Vishaya is district. Okay, the governor of the province is called Uparika, and the head of a district Vishayapati. Okay, the district is Vishaya, so obviously the head is Vishayapati. Okay, Uparika was expected to collect land revenue and maintain law and order with the help of the army. The Vishayapati was also expected to do the same within his jurisdiction. Okay, so these are all administrative positions. Okay, Vishayapati, Uparika, all these things. Now, during this period, there was an increase of smaller chieftains called Samantas or Bhogapatis. Okay, Samantas again. Okay, this is governance-related people. Okay, who dominated over a number of villages. The Vishayapatis and these smaller chiefs tended to merge with each other, and later on, the word Samanta began to be used indiscriminately for both. Okay, so we saw many terms, but finally, over time, Samanta became the common name for everything. Now, in the Rashtrakuta kingdom, the directly administered areas were divided into Rashtra, that is provinces. Okay, in the Rashtrakuta kingdom, the directly administered areas were divided into Rashtra, provinces, Vishaya and Bukti. So Vishaya is the district and Bukti will be even smaller unit. Okay, I think they are explaining here. The head of a Rashtra was called Rashtrapati, and he performed the same function as Uparika did in the Pala and Pratihara empire. Okay, so that is the only thing. Rashtrapati is here in Rashtrakuta and Uparika is there in Pala and Pratihara, but it's the same thing. Now Vishaya was a modern district and the Bukti was a smaller unit. Okay, now in the Pala and Pratihara empire, the unit below the Vishaya was called Pattala. Okay, so again, it's like different names in different places, that's all. Okay, so after Vishaya, in these places, Pala and Pratihara, they had one more unit called the Patala. Now, the precise role these smaller units is not known. Okay, what exactly they did, it's not known. It seems that their main purpose was the realization of land revenue and some attention to law and order. It seems that all the officials were paid by giving them grants of rent-free land. Okay, so it's like more of land is given, okay, more than cash. Now, this tended to blur the distinction between local officials and the hereditary chiefs and smaller vassals. Similarly, the Rashtrapati or governor sometimes enjoyed status of the title of a vassal king. Okay, so these people like are like becoming more powerful, and it's like their own subordinate king, they are the feeling they get. Now, below these territorial divisions was the village. The village was the basic unit of administration. Okay, the village administration was carried on by the village headman and the village accountant, whose post were generally hereditary. They were paid by grants of rent-free land. Again, rent-free land. Okay, there will be some terminology. Okay, here the headman was often helped in his duties by the village elder called the Grama Mahajana or Grama Mahatara. Okay, this is the headman is like helped by these people, the eldest people or the elderly group of the villages. Okay, these are even more simpler when you go to Chola. Okay, next one it will be much difficult. You will have much more village level thing, because in mains question have come. Okay, UPSC mains question have come about the Chola administration. We have to explain in detail village administration. Okay, that we'll see. Now we'll continue this. In the Rashtrakuta kingdom, particularly in Karnataka, we are told that there were village committees to manage local schools, tanks, temples and roads. They could also receive money or property in trust and manage them. These subcommittees worked in close cooperation with the headman and receive a percentage of the revenue collection. Simple disputes were also decided by these committees. Okay, so we have committees like this who will manage these local level issues. Okay, these infrastructure and all these things, tanks, school, temples and towns also had similar committees in which the heads of the trade guilds were also associated. Law and order in the towns and in areas in their immediate vicinity was the responsibility of the Kostapala or Kotwal, a figure made familiar through many stories. Okay, so these are like over generation, this is the name which is we are hearing, and that is how this name comes into picture. Okay, maintaining law and order in the town areas. Now, an important feature of the period was the rise in the Deccan hereditary revenue officers called Nath Gaundas or Desa Gramkutas. Okay, these are all very difficult to grasp actually, so just make notes. Okay, they appear to have discharged the same function as the Deshmukhs and Deshpandes of later times in Maharashtra. Okay, so again, comparative thing to make you understand. Okay, so this is in the Deccan and this is in the Maharashtra. Okay, later this development along with the petty chieftainships in North India, which we have just mentioned, had an important bearing on society and politics. As the power of these hereditary elements grew, the village committees became weaker. The central ruler also found it difficult to assert his authority over them and to control them. This is what we mean when we say that the government was becoming feudalized. Okay, so feudalism, what is feudalism? The whole idea I've explained, okay, in the first chapter. Now this again they are telling in this context of Deccan. Another point to bear in mind is the relationship of state and religion during that time. Many of the rulers of that time were devout followers of Shiva or Vishnu, or they followed the teaching of Buddhism or Jainism. They made handsome donations to the Brahmanas or the Buddhist Viharas or the Jain temples. But generally, they gave patronage to all the faiths and did not persecute anyone for his or religious belief. So if you see, overall till now, we have not seen any religious discrimination or caste system. Such kind of nothing was there. Okay, everywhere it is telling more of liberal thing. Okay, even Muslims were welcomed and allowed to preach their faith by the Rashtrakuta kings. Normally, a king was not expected to interfere with customs or with the code of conduct prescribed by the law books called the Dharma Shastras. But he did have the general duty of protecting Brahmanas and the division of society into four states or Varnas. The Purohita was expected to guide the king in the matter. But it should not be thought that the Purohitas interfered with state affairs or dominated the king. Okay, so again, it's like there is this Varna system and Purohita is treated well, but there is no discrimination or there is no superior treatment of any particular religion or any faith or any custom. Everything is treated equally only. Okay, or it's not even considered. Okay, so Medhaditi, which we saw, okay, a foremost expounder of Dharma Shastra in this period, says that the king's authority was derived both from the Dharma Shastra, including the Vedas, and from the Arthashastra or the science of polity. Okay, so everything, both are followed, and this Medhaditi, you know, it's like a liberal writer at that time, okay, who told like we should fight against injustice and we should raise our voice, all those kind of things. His public duty of Rajdharma was to be based on the Arthashastra, that is, on principles of politics. That really meant that politics and religion were in essence kept apart. Religion being essentially a personal duty of the king. Okay, so again telling like religion is not too much interfered. But the kings were not dominated by the priesthood or by the sacred law expounded by them. Okay, so this is a statement which you should know. Okay, because in most kingdoms it's like or the timeline it is like the Purohitas overpowered okay the king, but here it is not like that. So I think that is it, this chapter. Yeah, so this is the questions you can pause and read. Okay, it's like now you will be finding very easy, but confusing terminologies we saw. So hope you made that Excel sheet. Okay, just recollect it just before prelims, and that is all you need unless you are a history optional student. Okay, for prelims and the mains general GS1 you need only this glancing thing, which is enough. Okay, based on political thing I am telling, political history. Okay, next one, Chola Empire, we will see in the next video. Meanwhile, again, test series and all, if you have doubts, please watch the previous videos. Okay, already many times it is explained, but still students had doubt, that is why I showed you these slides at least. Okay, so any more doubts, just let me know. Okay, in comment section or WhatsApp me. Already my WhatsApp contact is, I think, almost everywhere it's there. Okay, so we'll come with the next video soon. Till then, enjoy your learning. Thank you. Have a nice day.